All right, in 2 Corinthians, Paul, of course, writing to the church there, this is the second time he's writing to them. And we see that Paul is concerned about the church and all this. And Paul says to, in verse 1, he said, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. And this morning, we know that Paul was, and we believe that Paul was an apostle from his testimony and the things that he stood for and the things that he did. And he says, by the will of God. And this morning, we as God's servants, as his people, we need to pray that we can know his will and stay in his will and try to do what he would have us do. And I know by myself that we've got the flesh to contend with, and we fail miserably. But the thing of it is, we always have the Father that we can come back and pray to Jesus that he'll vouch for us and give us a forgiveness for that. So he says here, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, with all the saints which are in all Achaia. And this Achaia was, I think, a little province there where that they were staying. But he says, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So he is saying to them, be at peace. And he's saying, grace be unto you. And he says that peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. And in verse 3, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and Father of mercy, and the God of all comfort. Now this is something this morning that you should lay hold on, that you should anchor yourself to this, because God the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercy. And we know this morning, if we didn't have mercy, we wouldn't be as close to the Lord as we are. We wouldn't have the assurance that we have that one day we'll be with him in glory. And this mercy is an everlasting mercy. And as I was speaking a while ago, God the Father and Jesus is sitting by his side making intercession for us. And listen, that's something that we can count on, that Jesus Christ will vouch for ourselves, for us, and he knows how. And of course, this is a Trinity. The Father he's God, but he's still a Son. But anyway, he came to this earth in a fleshly body. And he knows what our problems is. He knows how that the flesh can act, because he had to put up with it too. Now he overcame it, which we don't. But here he says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercy and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all of our tribulations, that we may be able to comfort them which are in trouble, any trouble, by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. And so this morning, we that are saved, we that are comforted by our Father and by the Holy Spirit, can use this comfort to comfort others. And this is our responsibility this morning, to, if we have the opportunity to speak a word of comfort to someone, we need to do it. We need to be right there ready to say and to help any of our brother and sister. And we need to be able to talk to a sinner and try to tell them about the Lord Jesus Christ. And a lot of times this would be a comfort to them, because a lot of times they don't really understand about the Lord Jesus Christ, and we can comfort them by telling them these things. And so he says here that who comforteth us, talking about God, us in our tribulations, and speaking of the tribulations that we have in our life, Jesus has promised, and God has promised, that these tribulations that we have, that through that tribulation, He would always make a way. Now, He's not going to stop the tribulation, listen, but it's like Paul and some of those that had to go through those tribulations. He made a way through that tribulation, which is comforting to know, because when you start into something like this and something that's bothering you, or you're having problems, knowing that the Father has already made a way through that tribulation, and just have the patience and be patient with it, and listen, that tribulation will eventually open up to where that you can go through it and have it behind you. And this is about the same thing where he says here that he who comfort us in our tribulations, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. And so when we get through a tribulation, listen, we're comforted. And we, this morning, I know myself, when we have tribulations come upon us and God solves that problem and he gives us a way through that thing, listen, you don't forget it overnight. And you want to keep praising Him and praising Him and praising Him for it. And that's when things are really a whole lot better than the tribulation was, and you can enjoy some of the God's blessings. Here again in verse 5, for as the suffering of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounded by Christ. Now, again, we see here a double claim here when he says, for as the suffering of Christ abounds in us, so our consolation also abounds by Christ. And in 2 Corinthians, I believe, if you would turn over there in chapter 4, I want to read just a little something to you here in verse 8. Chapter 4 and verse 8. He says, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not despaired, persecuted, but not forsaken, cast down, but not destroyed. In all of these things that we see here, these troubles, and we know that the devil is sitting back laughing at us and trying to keep a trouble in our ways, but in all of these, he says here, but we are not cast down. We're not defeated. And so this morning, even if we're having troubles on every side, if we're distressed, and if we're perplexed, and we're persecuted, and you know, this persecution is a heavy thing, because we are studying in our Sunday school, our afternoon evening class, some of the things that in Exodus about the temple and all of this. And one of the things that I see in this thing is that some of those people back in it speaks of it in Hebrews, were that they were persecuted, and they were clothed in animal skins, and they lived in caves, and they were persecuted. Now, people, we are not persecuted like they were then. Because, listen, one thing is that people have got too smart in some ways. But listen, you take somebody that makes you go out here and live in a cave, or beat you or persecute you in these other ways, and you don't have clothing, you don't have food, that's persecution. And listen, there was years and years and years of that people lived in that condition, and they carried the gospel, and they brought it on through that time, and we can thank the Lord that they brought it through, because we have a copy of it. We have the word here this morning that come through all of that persecution and all. And so here he said persecuted but not forsaken. And so in our persecution, the Lord never forsakes us. The Lord never turns His back on us. The Lord is always there. A lot of times we don't understand what the persecution's about. But let me tell you this morning, that God knows about it. He knows what it's all about. He knows why he's letting Satan do these things to us. But all in all, when we come through it, we're much stronger, and we understand more of the love of God. And so he's saying here this morning, for we which live are, in verse 11, are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. And this manifest this morning is one of the ways that it exposes, or it prints out, or it tells what is going on. And a manifest is like a ship log or something like that, where names are wrote down and all of them. But he says here that we are to manifest the Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh. And this is where the rub comes, if you would, because a lot of times when you get out in the world and you see all of this wickedness and everything, and you have an opportunity to exalt the Lord and testify or give a testimony in front of people like this, the flesh says, no, you wait for another season, because these people won't hear you. They won't listen to you. Well, that's the same thing this morning that Jesus had while he was here upon this earth. He told these people, he told the Pharisees, he told the Sadducees all about these things, and they wouldn't listen. But the thing that was, it didn't keep him from telling them. And it's the same way with Paul here, when he stood before Felix and all of those, and he testified that Jesus Christ was Lord, it didn't slow him up. And we this morning ought to use that as an example, and that we ought to try to be a testimony for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so this mortal manifest in our mortal flesh, so then death worketh in us, but life in you. And so Paul here is saying that death worketh in them, and they were on the verge many times of being killed. Even one time there, I think it was I can't remember the guy's name, but he made golden shrines for this goddess, and they were about to kill Paul. And he got away. The Lord got him out of the situation, and he had many times shipwrecked and all of these things, that death was right at his door. But he said, so then death worketh in us, but life in you. And that death that he was talking about exposed the word of God to us, to give us life. Now we have, in verse 13, we have the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, therefore speak. And so Paul here is spoken this, and he said, I believe it, and I'm speaking it again. And this morning, people, when we have an opportunity to tell someone about the Lord Jesus Christ, and we know the truth about the Lord Jesus Christ, we should not hold back. We should be able to tell that person with a heart of love, not in a haughty type spirit, but with a heart of love. We should be able to tell that person about the Lord Jesus Christ. And listen, if they don't listen, it's off you. And you know, we've mentioned it time again, you know, when they went into the city and the Lord told us that you go in there and you testify to these people, and if they don't listen, he says, you just leave them alone, go out of the city, shake the dust off of your feet, and leave them, because you have done your thing and they won't listen, so it's their problem. And that's why this morning that we ought to be ready at any time to testify or to witness to anybody about the Lord Jesus Christ. Now here in verse 15, 14, knowing that he which raiseth up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus, and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sake, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but through our outward man, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. And again, this renewing comes by a lot of times by persecution, It comes by hearing God's word. It comes by studying God's word, and many different things that renews our life, our inward man. And so he says here in verse 17, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, and a moment is very short time, and you compare that to eternity, that moment that you might back off and not testify to someone might keep them from being saved. And so he says here, for your light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceedingly eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. And so this is a thought here this morning, that the way that we should look at things is very important. Now back in our lesson again over in 2 Corinthians 1, look at the verse 7. It says, our hope of you is steadfast, knowing that as ye are partakers of the suffering, so shall ye also be of the consolation. And so the consolation is the reward of being in heaven with the Lord Jesus Christ. And the suffering here is but for a moment. The suffering is for a little while. And the suffering may kill the body, but it cannot do any harm to the soul. And so it's just the consolation is a reward. Then in verse 8, for we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble, which came to us in Asia, that as we were pressed out of measure above strength, and so much that we despaired even of life. And this is the one I was talking about a while ago, that guy, I believe his name was Demetrius, was making these things. But they were going to kill Paul and them. But here in verse 9, he says, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God, which raised the dead. So here we see Paul again as he is trying to tell the people some of the things that he had went through. And then in verse 10, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that he will deliver us. And so it's not a one-time thing with Paul and them of being delivered, because he said we trust that they will deliver again. For our rejoicing, in verse 12, is this, the testimony of our conscience, that in simplicity and godliness, or godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God, we have had our conversations in the world, and more abundantly to you, Lord. So, again here, he is rejoicing in the fact that that he has a testimony to these people, and that he is depending upon the Lord to see him through. For in verse 13, for we write none other thing unto you than what you read or acknowledge, and I trust you shall acknowledge even to the end, as also you have acknowledged us in part, that we are your rejoicing, even as ye also are ours in the day of the Lord. And so in this we see here that we can be a rejoicing to someone, and someone else can be a rejoicing to us. And I know most of us have experienced people that we can rejoice in, that they're a blessing to us. And we sometimes fail to tell them this thing, but we need to be more closely connected with our brothers and sisters, to tell them when you help me in some way, you make me rejoice, and I want to thank you for it, because that's the only place that we can get any pleasure. It's always out of our brothers and sisters. The devil sure ain't going to help us to rejoice. But in this, he said in 15, and in this confidence I was minded to come unto you before, that you might have a second benefit. and to pass by you into Macedonia, and to come again out of Macedonia unto you, and of you to be brought on my way toward Judea. When I therefore was thus minded, did I use lightness or the things that I proposed to do? I proposed according to the flesh, that with me there should be yea, yea, and nay, nay. But as God is true, our word toward you was not yet made. So Paul is having a problem here, and I understand that he had some things he needed to say to the church, but it was not ready for God. He says, for the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, even by me and Silvitissa and Timotheus, was not yea and nay, but in him was yea. For all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by us. Now he which established us with you in Christ, and hath anointed us in God, who hath also sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. Moreover, I call God for a record upon my soul, that to spare you I came not as yet unto Corinth, nor for that we have dominion over your faith, but are helpers of your joy, for by faith you stand. And I know these things that I am reading, a lot of times they don't mean a whole lot to just reading them, but I thank you that you've listened to what I had to read this morning. I'm sorry that it's not more earth-shaking than it was, but I'm glad that I had the opportunity to read these words to you. And the thing of it is, this morning, is that we need to love one another a whole lot more than we do. We need to trust one another and have a better attitude towards one another, and to pray for one another, and to love one another more than we do. So we thank you for this privilege that we have to read God's word, and I hope it's something I've read, and I know it will, something, because God's word won't return unto him void, and there'll be something somewhere down the line, maybe it may be tonight when you wake up about 12, 1 o'clock, and you think, well, what was that he's saying? Who knows? But anyway, thank you all for listening to my reading.